right. Welcome, everybody, to the sixth episode of the Philosophy of Power podcast. It is February 18th, 2017, and it is approximately 7:30. We're supposed to start at 7, but my computer's a moron. And, yeah, so that's just how it works. You know, we just have all kinds of technical difficulties, and we got my divine intellect trying to figure it all out. So we have a full panel today. Actually, our guest is going to be Brett Stevens, and he's the author of Nihilism, the what's the subtitle there? Nihilism, the
A philosophy based in nothingness and eternity.
There you go. And we have with us Dion Clark. Dion Clark has been a regular feature on this this broadcast thus far. Good to have you with us, Dion.
Thanks for having me on. I'm like the unofficial co-host, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So we're basically having like three co-hosts. The other person here we're going to have is Libertarian Realist. Good to have you on with us again. And he was on, I think, what was it, episode 5 or no, it was 4 maybe. But it's good to have you on with us again, Brad.
Yes, greetings to all your listeners once again.
So I haven't read your book, Brett, and I heard from somebody that it was not available on Amazon right now. Are they out of print or something, or something going on there? I don't know.
Well, first, thanks for having me on the show. This is a lot of fun. Second, it should be available on both Amazon and Barnes & Noble, and you can also get it through Hell's Headbangers, which is pretty much the best underground metal distro out there. So should be available on all of them. If Amazon's having transient errors, we just have to call and tell them to reboot.
Right. Now, usually I would have read the book prior, but I didn't really have the time at this moment, but I will do that in the future. Sounds like a really interesting book, but I guess we can use this episode as a kind of a preview, if you will, to what it is you talk about in there, your philosophy. I'm assuming that you're writing about your personal philosophy. And generally, when I talk about nihilism, I'm using that term in a meta-ethical sense, meaning no objective, meaning morality or purpose. And I have a feeling that you are employing the term differently. And so I was hoping to explore that, how you use that term. So maybe we could start off with, you know, with the subtitle there.
Based in nothingness and eternity. Well, your basic idea here is that this is an extreme form of active nihilism, which is a type of very affirmative and aggressive realism. And the message of this is that there is no inherent truth, purpose, or value in existence. We cannot say, just looking out there at the universe, that it tells us that there's writing on the wall, that there's an inherent purpose, there's an innate meaning. Instead, these things vary with the individual, but they are not arbitrary, meaning that they are adaptive responses, much as we would see in any kind of Darwinian analysis. So your smarter creatures tend to do things differently than your dumber ones, and people who've got certain outlooks that are perhaps more eternal than others are going to have different needs than others and are going to see different things as true than them. And the fact is that we're looking at the bell curve here in humanity. People are different, and most people can perceive very little. And if you have someone who is intelligent and dedicated toward finding out how the world works, they're going to see an entirely different world than what other people do, and the two are not going to be compatible. The traditional method by which conservatives try to keep everybody in line is arguing for some sort of innate or inherent truth to the universe and existence and all that, but that presumes it would be universally perceived, meaning that all people could see it equally, and we know that's not true, so we have to throw that model out and instead say nothing is necessarily true. You just have to pick the best way to adapt to reality itself and get rid of this human idea of true, this human idea of morality, the human idea that we can communicate truths and people can receive them exactly as they were transmitted. All of that needs to go away. Instead, it's just you and reality. You know how actions you've taken have worked out in the past. You know how others' actions have worked out. So you have a reasonable ability to anticipate what's going to happen when you act. So the question is, did you intend those results? And that's really the only moral question you have, is make sure you're going to achieve the results you intend. And over time, I think that pushes people toward a much saner type of morality than your good, bad, binary that comes to us from Judeo-Christianity, commerce, and about a million other sources. Hope that helps.
So you're basically saying purely rational imperatives, purely rational oughts, not like Kantian categorical imperatives, correct?
Definitely.
So it's like if I want X, then I ought to do Y?
Correct. It's just a very logical system. Exterminate all rational thought, I say.
Okay, so this is interesting because, I mean, I've written pretty much the same thing in my book, and it was almost purely on metaethics, on metaethical nihilism and how that affects, then like the last chapter goes into how moral nihilism negates much of political thought to political ideology, like contractarianism or things like that, or property. Then I go into the emotive uses of propertarian language. Like when we say something is mine, we're either referring to some legal concept or we're referring to some sort of emotion about a feeling or affinity towards a thing, a kind of feeling about no one ought have access to this thing unless I say so, or, you know, unless I grant them access. So it's kind of it's an emotive usage of language. And that's how in the book I talk about how basically morality is about power. It's not about truth. And then, you know, talking about moral terms and sentences, we're just expressing emotion, basically. You know, X is wrong is akin to boo X. And sometimes it's a bit more complicated than that, but I'm just giving you a general overview. So I see like religion and politics and morality as just basically a tool for power. It has nothing to do with truth at all.
Definitely. Most things are a means to an end. In my view, because I'm a fairly strict Nietzschean, the end is adaptation. We're here to adapt and thrive. And if we can't figure out how to do that, we should be exterminated.
I see. So I actually defined power as, one of the ways that I think the term power can be employed is the ability to fit into a particular environment, or as you say, adaptation. So when people think of power, they usually think of something like, mighty and strong and, you know, just physical force. And power can actually be, you know, the ability to manipulate. It can be its lack of size, its ability to infiltrate the body and take down an opponent much larger than its size than it is, right? So power is when defined in that sense, because, you know, you had like the social Darwinists who had a very strict and narrow understanding of might or power, if you will, where only the stronger, the physically stronger survive. They are the best adapted. And of course, we know that that's, yeah, in general, that's true, but it's not always the case. Power can be a lot of different things.
Yeah, that's a total, the might makes right crowd, I think, are engaging in a total oversimplification. When we say power, we mean the ability to do things. And then the question is, well, what's worth doing here on planet Earth? Well, you adapt, and then you can improve in qualitative level. You can improve in the quality of what you're doing. Other than that, you're pretty much out of options. It's shopping, it's drinking, you know, there's really just not that much else that's all that interesting. So I completely agree. Trying to, you know, it's true, as you said, that oftentimes the bigger and stronger is going to be the better adapted. But there's also a lot of space for the crafty and the intelligent and those who can plan ahead and those who don't engage in unnecessary fights. And one of the aspects for me about nihilism is that it removes the humanist level. We're no longer thinking about things as a human being. We're thinking about them as an animal, as a raw force of logic and passion and a feral and atavistic beast in nature. And when you think about life that way, you've got a sense of power in that you've cast aside a whole lot of illusions and you can maximize your position.
Yeah, it sounds very it sounds Humean too, in the psychological sense. Like, you seem to be like, where values, reason. So morality is based on sentiment, not reason, in Hume's metaethics. And so the reason is just a tool to achieve those ends, those you know, sentiments, those subjective aims, if you will. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, morality is subjective. Now, I was just kind of seeing how you anybody else want to jump in here? Anybody?
Well, I'm curious as to whether you believe that the ends or the purposes we choose in life are beyond reason, that reason is just a tool for achieving the ends, or that reason also needs to be used to define those ends.
You know, that's a really excellent question. I'm not really a big fan of Enlightenment thought at all, because I think reason is very poorly defined for a reason. It's designed to manipulate as a term. And so to me, there's the question of logical thinking, and that immediately ties to realistic thinking. It must be logical in that it's a well-formed statement, and it must also correspond to things we find in reality. And so in that sense, our ultimate goal is adaptation, so we know that, and we can use our intelligence, our logical facilities, as you would call it, to find that end. But at the same time, we're not really going to – it's not like we're going to really invent a new end, if you know what I mean. We're just going to find different variants of that one. So it's less of a – it's less of what the term reason implies, which is deducing our way to an end, and more of just looking at what's actually there and finding a way to adapt to it.
I should have been more specific, because when I said reason, I meant logic, and that's
sure,
just how,
sure.
I guess maybe people who are, I don't know, dealing in philosophy usually mean that too. I should have prefaced that, but go ahead. Is there anybody else that wants to?
Well, I would agree that logic can't in itself be used just in an abstract way to define one's purpose or to lay out a moral code that one must follow. It has to be grounded. It has to have a starting point in reality, right? And so for me, my starting point would be human nature, to the best that I can, through introspection or observation, empirically discover what my true nature is. And then from that, I try to derive my true purpose.
Sounds right.
Now, I'm curious as to why I don't think – I heard your interview on Red Ice also, by the way. I thought that was very interesting, and I don't really think I have many major disagreements with you, except why would you call your philosophy nihilism? That, to me, nihilism just seems like a broken word if you're trying to communicate something positive. Like, if I was to call race realism racism, racism is just like a broken word colloquially. So why do you call your philosophy nihilism?
Another great question. My answer to that is that we live in a time where we really need to reevaluate all our values, and the major problem that we run into as a species is that we have calcified thinking, sort of like tunnel vision, usually based in our natural tendency towards solipsism. So what we really need is somebody to set everything on fire and keep only that which really is relevant and throw the rest out. And nihilism means that. It is a reduction to the absolute nothingness and then rebuilding from that, because we are our own worst enemy. The human mind invents all sorts of reasons and needs and impulses and other desires and feelings and judgments, and these end up misleading us, and nihilism is the antidote to that. It's just like a big old Brillo pad, you know, clearing out the brain. And that's why I chose the word, because I think it is the only actual form of nihilism as a philosophy is what I describe. When people talk about nihilism as this kind of kitty anarchism, you're like, well, if you really were that nihilistic and cared about nothing, you probably wouldn't be here. You'd just quit talking about it and or die. You know, that's a justification, and it makes no sense. So for me, nihilism is anti-humanism. It is just recognizing that we are our own worst enemies, and we are prone to illusion, and we need to just scrape that Brillo pad through the brain and clear out all of those human-based, those anthropocentric illusions. Hope that answers your question.
All right.
Yeah, I often run into, and actually I talk about in the intro of the book, I define all the different ways that the term nihilism is used in its origins, because it does have a lot of hefty baggage especially nowadays, where, because nihilism is a term that was popularized by opponents in philosophy would accuse, you know, they would, people in philosophy would accuse one another of being nihilists. And so it became like a dirty term for a while. And then, of course, Nietzsche didn't really help because he was employing it to talk about different psychological states. And then in metaethics, we're using it to talk about something more quantitative, like, you know, a metaethical position concerning what moral terms actually mean, or, you know, whether they have emotive meaning, or whether they're cognitive, or whether they're true or they're false, whether they have objective reference within the world properties, or whether they don't. And so nihilism has a jillion different meanings, and so it's very important to define that term. Dion, you got anything to add? I'm going to try to – there was somebody who wanted to call in, and I was trying to pull them up here.
Yeah, I just wanted to kind of piggyback off of what Brett was saying, that, you know, his whole idea of nihilism is basically the society we live in now is really emotional-based in its ideologies, and basically all we got to do is basically burn it all down and start over again, because everything that we're surrounded by is basically a lie.
Pretty much.
But don't you think that some people, particularly on the left side of the bell curve, need myths and metaphors and what you might call lies just in order to feel that they have any kind of purpose in life?
You know, that's a good point, but I think that what they need is leadership more than anything else, especially on the left, let's call it four-fifths of the bell curve. What people really need is an aristocracy above them, and there's really no way getting around that. I don't think it's purely an intelligence-based thing. There's several inputs. One, obviously, is raw intelligence, but another one is having the will to care about these things, like leadership, politics, adaptation, all of these things. Those do not appeal to a whole lot of people, even really intelligent people. And the third, of course, would be the experience, because they are esoteric or cumulative genres, so you have to dig deeper into them. And, you know, it's interesting we bring up the history of nihilism here, because to me it seems like it was used as a catch-all for people who, in theory, believed in nothing. But what I found, looking into that through a process of logical examination, was, in fact, these people were true believers in something, in themselves. And so at that point, I started seeing what Nietzsche was calling nihilism as something more like solipsism. It's people who believe that they are the world, and that what they feel and think and desire is more important than reality itself. And they'll never come out and say it like that, but that's how they act. And, you know, Dion had an excellent point about the emotional nature of current society. That is completely derived from solipsism. We have a bunch of monkeys, because humans are basically monkeys, sitting around telling each other that they're super smart, and then they're agreeing that they all have these impulses and desires and wants and feelings, and those must be validated by the group, because essentially they're afraid of reality, and they want their feelings and their perceptions and intent to come before reality in terms of what they notice and in terms of what everyone acts on, because that makes them feel less like they are helpless little monkeys waiting to die in basically a cold and possibly empty universe.
And I really think that the internet has actually made this worse, because people can go out there and spread their opinions out everywhere. So everybody has this ego-driven feeling that their opinion matters and everybody needs to hear it, and if anybody disagrees with them, they should just be taken away with and not have any say whatsoever. And it seems like everybody's getting more polarized and forceful in their own opinions, whether they're right or wrong. It just seems that if anybody disagrees with you, you're automatically should be done away with.
You know, that's a great point. We're reaching a stage of polarization. My friend Billy Roper describes it as the Balkanization of the West. We've got all these different groups, religious, ethnic, cultural, political, social, all warring it out in this society. They all form identities, and people cling to these groups because they need that identity, and that serves a very positive purpose for them. This is not a bad thing. But the fact is, these groups can't get along. If you choose one culture, you have, by by doing that, you have excluded every other culture. And so you've rejected all of them. And I think we're finally recognizing that. We've sort of been going along with the illusion that we can all get along. And now we're starting to realize, like, yeah, I've got my tribe, and I want to hang out with my tribe. And what we do should be our concern alone. And everyone else just needs to back off. And so I think that's why you're getting that polarization right now.
Sorry, I hate to cut in. Dion, can you check and see if there's anything going on with our YouTube feed there?
Yeah, I got it open right now. There's not really a whole lot going on right there.
No, I meant it's broadcasting, right?
Yeah, it's on. It's going.
Okay. All right. Well, somebody said they were still waiting for it, so they must be having some issues on their end.
Yeah, I figured you wanted me to watch the Spurg chat. So.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I appreciate that. Let me see if I can bring this guy in. Let me see here. Okay, so not with this one. I have to go to the other one. All right, we can do that. All right. I'm sorry. I'm troubleshooting. You guys just keep doing what you're doing. You're doing great.
So I think nothing basically matters. Anyone want to challenge me?
Well, in an objective sense, you are correct, because there is nothing inherent in existence that would require anything to matter, at least as far as I can tell. So things only matter relative to individual consciousnesses.
Pretty much. And those consciousnesses are not equal, so it's very hard to say that there are any universal truths out there, or even the ability to communicate something that approximates a universal truth. And that sort of undoes the linchpins and underpinning of Western civilization since the Enlightenment. Oops.
Well, there are descriptive truths, right? You believe that what we perceive to be reality is factually to be reality?
No, not really. I think there's a ability to derive certain working principles of reality, but what we're perceiving is heavily filtered through our minds. This goes back to Kant again, but I would also say that Schopenhauer is sort of the master of this. Our brains form a narrative of the things around us that make sense for our brains to work. They're like computers. They have to avoid crashing. They have to keep processing and avoid going into an infinite loop or something like that. So they just do the best they can, and I think they filter out most of what's happening around us, just so that we're able to process what our brains can handle and not anything more, so we don't shut down. We can describe our reality true, and we can be correct in a lot of assessments, but not absolutely correct. And I don't think it can be communicated.
I missed some of that. I apologize.
Boy, well, clearly we didn't evolve to become truth machines, truth-seeking machines, or truth-discovering machines. We evolved in order to survive, and to the extent that information is useful to our survival, we acquire the ability to perceive it.
Absolutely. We're there for the four F's: feeding, fighting, fleeing, and reproduction.
I'm going to try to bring this caller in. Just give me a second here. Let's see if this works. Call failed. God damn it. All right. So that didn't work.
Well, James.
Yes.
The people on the YouTube channel said they can't hear anything.
They said they can't hear anything?
Right.
What the fuck, man? All right. Shit.
Well, anyways, I'm recording it on my end, so I can just send you the file later and we just upload it.
Oh, that would be awesome. Thank you very much. Yes, I guess we'll just have to freaking do that. That sucks. Well, that's got to be YouTube, because it says I'm broadcasting right now. I don't know what's going on, man. Oh, wait a minute. What's this? Can everybody hear me now? Holy shit, that was my fault. So for some reason, the mic was turned off. They can hear me now. I know they can. Hello? I'm sorry, folks, but I'm blonde. All right.
I can hear you.
Okay. I'm still getting used to this. This is only episode 6, and I thought I had everything figured out, and then I had mic issues, and that wasn't my fault. That I don't know what the fuck was going on there, but it just wasn't picking up my mic for some reason, even though I have it plugged in, so I don't get that. But yeah, for those of you just listening now, I just hit the red button that had the mic was apparently turned off for some reason. I have no idea why. We're recording, and you'll be able to hear everything that you didn't hear before when I don't know, in the podcast later. So thank God for Dion.
Well, I got an automatic Skype recorder, so.
Oh, okay.
It just automatically goes on.
I got you. All right. Where were we? Okay, so you were saying that, so am I to take it that you're an idealist then?
Me? Or yeah. Who?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Brett. Are you an idealist, ontologically speaking? So do you believe, like, do you have some sort of representationalism?
Oh, definitely. I think we're all living in the house that Schopenhauer built, if you know what I mean. I consider myself a German idealist, and I pair that with the ancient pagan Hindu belief from the Bhagavad Gita, which is a similar type of idealism. And this is philosophical idealism, meaning that we believe the universe is composed of something like information, thought, or structure, as opposed to tangible material per se. And that fits very much into the Platonic idea of forms, which are generally misinterpreted now because they sort of got shifted into Neoplatonism and dualism. But it's actually a more complex philosophy than that. At the same time, it's the only one that adequately describes what we're seeing here in existence.
Okay. So basically, you know, Schopenhauer's
what we're seeing here
thing was that everything is a representation of force, right? I talked about this in a chapter in my book called "The World as Will to Power and Representation," but
good title.
Yeah. Well, it was kind of just summarizing Nietzsche's will to power in the ontological and in the societal and I'm trying to remember there was another category that I was covering, but I don't remember offhand because I'm all right. Let me try to bring this guy in again. Let's see what happens. God damn it.
Technology is awesome.
Yeah. All right.
It always works great when it works, but that's usually far and few between.
I was going to say that's the rare day, but it is great when it does. You know, it feels so good. You're like, man, I feel just like the guys in the commercials. Oh, wait, yeah.
Yeah, this is all right. Come on now. This is ridiculous.
Well, it's interesting how psychologically we always adapt ourselves to whatever we're used to, if we expect. Like right now, we're living in a fantasy future that almost everybody who ever existed before us could only dream of living in, and yet we get frustrated over these little technological hiccups that we are unable to get through.
You know, that's a really good point.
Yeah, I mean, nobody's happiness really ever sustainably increases, no matter how much materially more prosperous they become, right?
It's all relative to what you know. So, I mean, if you grew up with computers that were one speed and the next generation of computers are only twice as fast, you're like, beh, not a big deal.
Oh, I remember back in the 80s and 90s, my dad had this, it was an IBM XT. And we thought that thing was the shit. You know, had the green screen and everything. You could play like little Pong on it and shit, little games. And, yeah, you know, watching it, then he got this, think it was a Gateway or something, and it was like one of the first super color VGA screen, and start playing like Mortal Kombat on there and shit. You know, thought that was the great thing. And then Game Gear came out by Sega. But this, I don't know. I'm just like, I'm not very good with technology. Hold on, let me see if I can bring him in now. Let's try it. God damn it. God. I don't know if it's him or what. I don't know if he's just not, I mean, he's there. He just says, all right, well, whatever. All right, so forget that. Let's just go on with the show, man.
Onward into countless battles.
Yes, next time I'll just tell him to hit me up on Skype.
Well, you know, that's one of the first rules of technology is just keep it as simple as humanly possible. The fewer working parts, the fewer screw-ups that are possible.
Yeah, I mean, speaking of technology, I got this, you know, we were talking about, this is way off subject, but we're here, right? So I got this little robot, man. It's really neat. It's called, it's by Anki, and the reason why I got it was because It's autonomous, and it's cute. It's like one of those robots from one of the Pixar movies. The name of that thing. I can't remember the name of it, but anyways, it's really cute, and it makes eye contact, and it recognizes faces. It knows when you're happy, when you're sad. Knows age, gender. It recognizes the difference between people. It memorizes your name. You can see what it sees. It has a built-in camera sensors so that it won't run off a table. And I thought, what an amazing thing for all intents and purposes, it really seems alive. And it just really illustrates the problem of other minds and, you know, like the hard problem of consciousness that we could get to a level where, I mean, we're not there yet, but this is a pretty extraordinary little robot, but we get to a point to where we have actual pea zombies walking around, and they act for all intents and purposes. They act conscious. They act like they have emotions, but they're just running programs.
You know, this brings up a point that I think we should all look at, which is that we like to think of human beings as having universal reason, meaning everyone has roughly the same tools. And I wonder if that's true in any way at all, because it seems to me that most people, the vast majority of them, are entirely stimulus-driven, and you're not really getting anything that much different than that robot. It's just much more personable.
Right.
Well, you know, these movies, there's been several of them that imagine a scenario where, I forget what they call it, you get some breakthrough where you can no longer distinguish between human consciousness and artificial consciousness. But in these movies, they always anthropomorphize the robots, so they look like dolls or they look human. What if it's just a box, but yet it still feels pain, and it still suffers like humans, but it's just a box, you don't have any empathy for it. It doesn't look like a human.
It's not cute and furry, in other words.
Yeah. But philosophically, it should be, you know, the same fundamental issue that, I mean, to me, the most horrifying future imaginable is one of unlimited immortality, where you can never die and you can just be reduced to a box and plugged in forever and ever and ever and made to suffer forever and ever and ever.
Ugh. Like the Dixie Flatline from Neuromancer by William Gibson. You guys read that? You remember this book?
No. What was that about?
It's a book called Neuromancer. It's about hackers and cyberspace, and was sort of it kind of gave the visual image to all the exciting new network technology that at the time was on green screens, so nobody was really all that excited. But then you tell them that it's going to be just like Tron, and they get all excited. But anyway, it's an interesting book, but in it there's a character whose his name is the Dixie Flatline. He's a hacker, and he is sampled into a ROM construct and kept in a cartridge, basically. And his last request of the people who've stolen him and used him at one point is for them to delete him, because he said it was not like living at all. And I think there's a real point to be made in what you've touched on there, which is that being immortal in a box with no ability to experience sensate reality might actually be very much not much fun.
Yeah, I think there's – I don't think that you know, we have a lot of these people, particularly atheist materialists, who talk about uploading your consciousness to a computer or something. And we've seen – I'm trying to remember the name of the movie, but there was this movie where this AI girl was created in this like, top-secret lab, and I can't remember. Anyways, because consciousness is a what it's like, because it's a qualitative thing. Okay, well, then he's just not going to get on. I don't see how it can be reduced to computer code, which is quantitative. So there's a real epistemic problem there that they'd have to contend with. So, but even if you could, I mean, even if you could create some sort of sentient robot, I don't think there would be any absolute way to know that thing is having a first person experience, because there's no way that we can know that anyone is having a first person experience other than ourselves.
Correct. And we should probably be skeptical of thinking too much of ourselves in that. I mean, we may be just very complicated robots. You know, at some level, we're based on synapses, on electrical impulses, electrochemical impulses. Those are, to some degree, binary. Now, they may also be spectral, meaning they can achieve an analog-style sliding value. But at the same time, we're not really constructed all that different from the robots we're making. We've just got a lot more years of evolution behind it, so there's a lot more finesse going on. And there's a few things I think our engineers haven't stumbled into that are sort of fundamental methods. But, you know, a lot of what goes on through our heads, if we're able to deconstruct what we're thinking, our brains are just picking out from a number of impulses for the one that seems to work best. And oftentimes, it's much closer to the animal or the robot than what we like to think of ourselves as these enlightened intellects.
The only person that I know for sure is experiencing consciousness right now is me. I operate under the assumption that you all are also conscious. I think it's a good assumption, but I can't know for absolute certain that you aren't just programs and that there's really nothing going on inside your heads.
Absolutely. I'm a Perl script.
David Chalmers, P-Zombie, is what we're talking about right now. In case you're just tuning in, we're talking about P-Zombies. And for all we know, liberals probably are P-Zombies. We should probably just think of them that way, actually. You know, when it comes
to... We need a set of glasses so we can identify them visually, like they live.
I'm just saying, when the right-wing death squads come, you know, just remember that they're just P-Zombies, so... We're just running programs, so it's okay to load them up in the boxcars and stuff. It's fine. It's all good. where the fuck was I? All right. So I've pretty much given up on trying to bring that viewer in. So next time, folks, we'll just have to do it. We're like, you guys contact me on Skype or something. I don't know who is... somebody's doing something with their mic there. Something with their, I think some crazy.
Sorry,
words.
I'm in my kitchen. You can mute me for a few minutes if you want. I attend to some stuff here in the kitchen.
All right. All right. So I noticed that you'd mentioned something. I can't remember if you mentioned this on your Red Ice interview or something, but I noticed that you and I are very anti-utilitarian, which makes sense since we're both Nietzscheans. My God, I don't know how do I fucking meet this guy? All right, hold on.
He's terminating leftists in the kitchen. That's what he was trying to gently say.
Yeah.
you know, dismembering people takes a lot of energy. I'm told. But yeah, you know, you're right. Utilitarianism is a real mess, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, it's just... Sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead. I was saying I don't know how to mute his mic, so.
Sorry about that. I can sign off here for a minute and then jump back in.
All right. Okay, so go ahead. Sorry. So weren't you like with the citizens for against utilitarian? I can't remember, some group or something.
Gosh, I barely remember. That was a ways ago, wasn't it? That was some time ago. But yeah, I'm completely opposed to utilitarianism. I find it to be one of the bleakest philosophies we have because it's a perversion of a decent philosophy, which is an attribute of realism called consequentialism. Ordinary consequentialism is that you measure your actions only by their effects and after effects and side effects and all that, but only by their effects in reality.
And that became perverted into utilitarianism, which is that you measure your actions by their effects as interpreted by a group of people and whether or not they like it. So basically democracy or demotism, as Mencius Moldbug calls it. And at that point, you've removed all of the realist elements from a realist philosophy, and you've created an entirely fake reality that you're then going to force people to obey and pretend that it's innate and inherent, and that it's, you know, you can see why nihilism rises against this kind of anthropocentric view of the universe, this humanism, this solipsism that is designed to create the sense that there is universal truth, but to measure it through humans. So it's a forgery. It's a sleight of hand. It's saying, oh, yes, we're measuring our actions by their effects, but we're measuring those effects through the interpretation of other people. And at that point, you're back to the popularity contest and everything gets icky.
Right. Yes. I was trying to pull up something here, that I'd written on, utilitarianism. Hold on. Is it, and this is actually from my book, but I'm hold on. Maybe I'm on the, okay, yeah, that makes sense. All right, utilitarianism is yet another secular attempt to provide an answer to the question, how ought a person behave? The utilitarian answer is that a person ought to act so as to produce the best possible outcome. What is the best possible outcome according to utilitarianism? Answer, whatever leads to the greatest happiness for the greatest number of people. What is happiness according to utilitarianism? Utilitarian John Stuart Mill, 1806 to 1873, defines happiness as intended pleasure and the absence of pain, and happiness as pain and the privation of pleasure. Utilitarian Bentham and Mill were both hedonistic, and they believed that happiness was a balance of pleasure over pain, and that these first-person qualitative experiences alone are intrinsically valuable or disvaluable. This is known as the utility principle. Concerning the utility principle, Jeremy Bentham said, Is it susceptible of any direct proof? It should seem not, for that which is used to prove everything else cannot itself be proved. A chain of proofs must have their commencement somewhere. To give such proof is as impossible as it is needless. Of course, it's needless if you just accept it on faith. Bentham derived the so-called value of this principle from the fact that humans seek pleasure and avoid pain. Now, if we were to, if this were true, you know, that humans seek pleasure and avoid pain, then it is logically impossible to derive any kind of ought from that. It would be like, you know, it's an is-ought fallacy. It'd be like saying, it is the case that I value aggression, therefore I ought to be, you know, or that I seek I have a proclivity towards aggression, therefore I'd be violent, right? That doesn't work. We can't work with that. So basically they're, you know, assuming the very thing they're trying to prove, and then they're working from a kind of a, is-ought fallacy, and then in calculating the consequences of a particular action, utilitarianism assumes the existence of intrinsic value, that is, something is put forth as a good in itself. And then in my experience, what the utilitarian means by the terms intrinsic value and intrinsic goodness is that, one, a thing is valuable or good independent of whether valuers' minds value it. It is worth choosing regardless of the consequences for doing so. The utilitarian wants to say that a particular thing is intrinsically good, end of story, no questions asked, so no one gets to ask or inquire about what makes X an intrinsic value, or what is the utility of X. And so, yeah, I mean, it's just based on a bunch of nonsense, basically.
Well, circular reasoning.
Yeah.
What you've described there is the classic begging the question leading to circular reasoning fallacy. They've assumed that there's this absolute good because it supports what they want to see as true, and therefore they're going to make all of us share in that assumption. You know, and it's really too Hegelian for me, this whole idea that, you know, that there is this universal truth and that we're able to define, using that, we're able to define pleasure as the absence of pain and vice versa and all that. I'm thinking that sounds so much like a reaction to life and not a perception of ourselves or of life itself. It's not really a choice. It's reacting. We're saying, okay, well, we don't want to experience pain. And to me, pleasure seems to be to come from having meaning in life. People want to know that they're expending their time on something that's worth doing, that they're going to achieve results that are good in a way that they would approve of, and that therefore, when they die, whatever they face after death, they're not going to feel like their life was entirely just a series of reactions and adaptations. They want to feel like they were masters of their fate, and they achieved something positive, and that's how you get meaning. And to me, that's where pleasure comes from. I think there's a component of it, kind of like we were talking about might is right, there's a component of it, and it's usually the case, that not having pain is necessary to have pleasure. But then again, it doesn't quite make sense to say that pain is the absence of pleasure.
Right. No, well, for me, it's like, ask yourself, what if the herd animal was given the ability to moralize, what system of morality would they come up with? Well, they would come up with utilitarianism, right? It's the greatest happiness for the greatest number of idiots, right? Basically, the average rube. And this kind of brings me into something I kind of detected, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I kind of detected in your Red Ice interview that you were somewhat aristocratic. Or no, it wasn't in your Red Ice interview. It was in a kind of interview on one of your blogs concerning your book. I could pull it up.
No need. I'll admit to it.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't have to bring out the thumb screws or anything. No, I'm very pro-aristocracy. There's a very simple reason. Leadership is such a specialized skill. It's like the ability to be a brain surgeon. You're born able to do it, and with hard work and some dedication, you can then make yourself able to do it, but not everybody can do it. I don't think you, I mean, I'm anti-egalitarian. I don't think you can take your average person and make them into a leader, and I don't think it would be fair to do so, because at that point they'd be beyond their competence level. I mean, watch what's happening to Angela Merkel in Germany as she watches her plans deconstruct around her. So you need people who are born to that kind of role, and that's mostly biological traits, but they also need to have some moral traits, like wanting to do the right thing, being geared toward beauty, that kind of thing. And then you need to refine them into leaders and give them the money and power so that they do good things with it. And that is really the essence of elitism, and it's the essence of realism as far as applied to humans. We are not equal, and the ones who are above the standard, significantly above, are the ones we should entrust with the wealth and power, instead of having everyone compete for wealth and power, and as a result, only the most vicious getting a hold of it, vicious and manipulative. And I think here in the West, 2016 to 2017 has been a huge time, because people are realizing that our leaders not just are not just bad people, they're corrupt people. they're not just incompetent, they're terrible, and they don't intend anything good. And we seem to be unable to get rid of them, and we seem to be unable to find a way to rein them in. And the reason is that they're just the wrong people to be leading us. We need noble people, people of high intelligence, of high moral caliber, of great vision, who enjoy making life better for other people. We need those in charge there. Instead, we're being held hostage by these vicious people who've learned to manipulate our system, are basically just parasites, and also are really bad at leadership, so everything's falling apart because they don't care about minding the store. They care about their own power. They want to make sure that they're able to advance themselves, and they've done that at the expense of us. And so all of us are kind of suffering through this, and what do you do? How do you get rid of a democratic leader? Well, we all approved of the person. Well, we can try to vote someone else in, but, you know, democracy is based on all these checks and balances in any democracy. And so there's only so much you can do to peel back this system that has benefited all these corrupt people.
Right. Now, in my kind of aristocratic philosophy, I see humans divided into two categories. So you have the atheist, which I talk about periodically throughout my book, and this is the type who is very skeptical, who is egoistic, not to be confused with egotistic, sees morality for what it is, sees that existence is a battlefield of competing powers, if you will. That is indeed what politics is about. It's about using the violence of the state to get people to do what you want them to do, to mold society in such a way that you want it to look. And this type of man, doesn't need some external source to dictate his purpose, to dictate his morality or any of that stuff. But as Nietzsche would say, he confers honor onto things. I believe it's section 260, Beyond Good and Evil. He talks about this, you know, this type man. And then you have the mass, which is the most people are very herd-like slave kind of animals that will, if they don't have a sky daddy, they'll erect one. If they don't have an earthly master, they'll vote one in within 24 hours. They absolutely need someone to dictate to them. And this is what the masses need. And most people don't educate themselves, don't invest in their intellect. They just passively believe whatever they hear on the news or whatever. They don't really do any kind of thorough research. They don't even ask very deep questions like, what am I saying when I say that X is wrong? Is there some reality to that? Like deep things, inquisitiveness, you know, taking pride in yourself enough not to be controlled by the matrix that has been erected around you, right? And seeing things for what they are. And I find that the only people who really do this are very few, and I call them the atheists. I don't know if that made any sense.
So, interesting. No, it makes good sense. I think you've adequately defined the roles for people. What I would say is that the masses acting as sheep-like as they do is the right thing. There is no equality. Therefore, their only role is ever going to be to follow, and they need good leaders to follow. It's up to us, those of us toward the right side of the bell curve, who are able to make these decisions, to make sure that we've got good leaders and good rules and principles in place so that they're able to just follow, because they can't make these decisions. They know it. And if we force them to through something like democracy, it's just going to become the kind of football game we've seen where it is now. Red team or blue team. You know, that's all they can do. And trying to force them to be more than that, I think, is typical Enlightenment era foolishness, where we're trying to make people all be equal with universal reason when, in fact, no such thing exists and nihilism refutes it.
Right. You know, it's funny because I actually discovered more nihilism through the Stoics, believe it or not. And they were moral realists. But that kind of outlook of seeing the difference between what really is and then what value judgments you make about them, and you see that there's two different things happening. You have the reality of what is, and then you have value judgments that you make about something. And, you know, believe it was in Shakespeare's, one of Shakespeare's plays, says, you know, nothing is good or evil, something like that, but thinking makes it so, right? And that's what we have. We have like this, we just have like a reality, things that are, and then we project, feelings onto things, right? We project, and this kind of gets into projectivism and metaethics, but it's this idea that we associate certain moods with certain things. And that's why we say that, you know, X is evil, for example. But yeah, that's pretty interesting. So yeah, that's,
sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. So that's kind of like, I don't even bother trying to, convert everyone to moral nihilism. Although I think that moral nihilism, as I define it in the active sense, I call it power nihilism, is, the red pill against white guilt and bad conscience. Because once you see morality for what it is, you can use morality without being manipulated by it. So like, for instance, when you have guilt, you know, you can ask yourself a series of questions. Is this person a family member? Do they contribute to my goals, to my survival in some way? Okay, cool. No. All right. Who gives a shit? It's just, you realize that guilt is just a mechanism that has helped us to survive, as, you know, groups generally survive. This isn't always the case, but they generally, you know, we've created the technology and the civilization that we have because of this psychological feature we call empathy, this ability to feel bad or feel someone else's pain. And this works fine for in-groups, but when you start having this pathological empathy that the left has, where, you know, everyone's just an American citizen, you know, just waiting to come here. They're all potential Americans. They're all potentially productive members of our society, you know, and we need to save everybody. And this is actually very destructive towards in-group interests, right? And men historically have been the ones who have drawn the line, who have said, these are the ones that are in and these are the ones that are out. And leftism seems to be a very female-centered, gynocentric, old woman's morality, if you will. To quote again there from Nietzsche. So that's the problem, but I think moral nihilism helps that, because then you see morality for what it is and you realize that it's not, you know, there's no objective way that things ought to be. These are just preferences. These are just feelings that we have. And thus being able to be outside of that matrix of morality, but yet use morality for your benefit as well.
You know, that's a great point. I always draw a distinction between methods and purpose. Morality is a method. As far as a purpose, we need to find something outside of morality itself, or it's going to become a begging the question fallacy, a circular reasoning type event. And to me, what makes most sense is adaptation. At that point, we can ask the question, as Plato did, well, what is the best order for us here as human beings? And I think that in the past, when people were clearer on things, they would have said, you know, the best order is probably one in which every group has its own space and rules itself. And therefore, the greatest empathy is found in not letting people in, because it will weaken their nations, it will weaken our nation, and everyone will end up hating each other, and then we're going to have a real mess. So that's what, when we as nihilists look at results-based morality, that's what we're talking about. Someone says, I want to come into your country, I'm cold and hungry, and I'll die otherwise. And you say, well, if I let you in, I'm going to be letting everyone in. And then that's going to destroy their countries. It's going to destroy my country. All of us are going to end up enemies because of this one event. So I can't do it, because the greater empathy is in turning off your empathy for a few moments and saying, I'm going to do what's sensible and logical instead. And I think that white people are a civilization in decline. The Western civilization has been in decline. I see leftism as sort of a byproduct of that. We got more individualistic, and now people are extremely neurotic. And I think you hit on what neurosis is when you were talking about projectivism, which is that they have certain emotional associations with events, but that's not cause-effect reasoning. They're just saying, well, this makes me feel this way, or this sort of creates this sensation in me. And so what they're thinking about doesn't really have anything to do with, if I do X, I get Y results and Z side effects. Instead, they're thinking about, you know, if I do this, it's going to make me feel good. And therefore, regardless of the results, because who really cares, I just want to feel good. It's sort of the heroin user mentality toward morality. You're like, well, you know, I don't know what's going to happen when I plunge this needle into my arm, but I think I'm going to feel better. So that's all that matters. If it feels good, do it. And, you know, we're slowly coming out of this time because it's been such a disaster, you know, at least the past 1,000 years of people following this individualistic path where they're like, what matters is my feelings and my social status and how I explain myself to others and how they think of me, instead of whether or not I did right as far as long-term results. And that goes back to that methods versus goals confusion. In the past, empathy was used as a method. Morality was used as a method. The goals were known, and sort of the overall structure, the principles, were based on a few things that we knew worked, including aristocracy. Well, we got rid of that, and so now, because we're basically headless, without having our leaders and without having any kind of real purpose, instead people are just going through and repeating methods from the past without purpose because they think that'll make them look better to other people. And I think that's all we got going on in the West these days.
Yeah, well, I've noticed that a lot of these slave herd moralities exalt, you know, empathy to some high pedestal and see it as like some sort of intrinsic value. And so when they go to moralize, they just automatically assume, you know, empathy, right? They automatically assume that as a value. What I'm saying is that moral nihilism helps you to step outside of that and to see that empathy is just a tool, right? And it can be used against you, and it can also be used for in-group, you know, for an in-group to survive. Obviously, you can't raise children without empathy. You have to have empathy for a baby who's screaming at, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning when you're trying to sleep. It's obviously something that we need to some extent, but it's definitely not something that should be exalted to the heights that it has been. And that's exactly what the herd animal will exalt, because empathy is that feature that makes humanity herd-like. It is the very thing that makes, you know, as Nietzsche said, you know, morality is the herd instinct in the individual. And I believe he was referring to empathy, but, you know.
Definitely. Well, our morality is based on empathy, so he has to be.
Right. I don't think all morality has to be. Like, look at master morality, for example. It's not based on empathy.
Well, that's true. And, you know, every group may have a different morality based on what it needs to do. For example, if you're talking about very simple people, they may need extremely simple rules, like the Ten Commandments. Don't rape. Don't murder. You know, these are, as a friend of mine said once, you know, when you get to the point where you have to write down you shouldn't kill people without reason, you know your society's really heading into the toilet. But at the same time, if you're talking about regular people whose lives are mostly bound up in, you know, their jobs, their families, their homes, their hobbies, that kind of thing, they may not really need complicated moral rules. And empathy may be what they do in order to avoid creating harm before someone wiser than them can get there and fix things as they actually need to be fixed. So, like you're saying, the master morality would be something for your upper echelons of society and would be entirely results-based and not really feelings-based. And you might even extend that to the example of the crying child at 4 a.m. If you had the child for a purpose, the fact that it's crying and upsetting you does not change that purpose. So you're not going to harm the child because that would defeat your own purpose. You would defeat your own will.
Yeah, no, I see that. I'm saying, you know, I'm not saying that... you know, there's a real problem with, and Nietzsche pointed this out, with universalizing morality, and that's exactly what pretty much all slave moralities and herd moralities try to do. They try to push this one system onto everyone else, this one system of virtues, and Master morality is not like that. You know, master morality is for the atheists, right? And stop trying to convince. We can't convince everyone. No one's going to be that intellectual or have the intellectual faculties. Most people are not going to have the intellectual faculties to understand what we are discussing here. Let's just put it that way. To understand what morality actually is, to understand a lot of these things. And so there's no need to, you know, try to create a movement around that of nihilists or something, right? That's not going to work. We'll always be a minority. Atheists will always be a minority. And the average person is always going to need some sort of crutch, you know, religion, morality, or something to dictate to it, right? Because that's how they feel safe. That's the soil in which they feel most comfortable.
You know, you're right, and it's kind of a brilliant design. For most people, what we're talking about here might be incomprehensible, but it would also be useless. They're just not concerned with it. They're concerned with having lives in their local areas, with their social group, with the things they know how to do, with all the things that fascinate them in life. And so what we're talking about here would probably have very little utility for them.
Right, because, I mean, for some people, being in a religion is going to suit their power interests. And, you know, being in a collective like that benefits them. And it's only when that collective turns against them or something that they begin to look at alternative things. Oh, you mean Christianity is false? Oh, okay. Then they become open to the truth. But it's not that necessary. I should have been more specific. But it's not that necessarily that everyone can't or that most people can't understand these things. It's that they don't want to and they don't care about it. They're not open to it because it doesn't suit their power interests. And that's just the way evolution works. I mean, we don't perceive radio waves because it wasn't in our power interest to do so.
You know, that's true. And people, the other thing that I think would be a big factor in here is that even if they could understand these things, they would probably just turn them into terrible end results. If you give somebody who is not ready for power a whole bunch of power, they will most likely abuse it. And as a result, you'll have terrible results. People are like that. There's only some who are fit to wield power, and the others really need to be ruled by them. Otherwise, you have the inverse situation, which is where the rest oppress the best instead of the best oppressing the rest. And as a result, you have terrible decision-making like we see in the West today.
Right. And, of course, the kind of system we have here in America is where the average rube, the average person is the ignorant, you know, the average ignorant person is deciding who's going to rule over the rest of mankind. And that simply breeds mediocrity. It breeds what we have now. And all of this is a kind of a remnant of Christianity. Leftism, you know, liberal, socio-political liberalism is all derived from Christian values, from slave morality. And so it's just it's basically a Christian morality without the God. I mean, the feminists and the, you know, the progressive type liberals, these are all fucking the Puritans of their time. That's what they are. They're all on witch hunts trying to burn the racists and you know, anyone who doesn't hold to their Victorian sensibilities, you know, anyone who's different than them, well, we just have to rid them. You know, they are the, you know, they are just basically the Puritans who come in to deny the way human nature actually works. And pulse check. Are you still with us, Dion?
Yeah, I'm still here. I'm okay. Just listening to you guys go.
Oh, all right. I was just making sure you're still with us, that I didn't drop your call. I hope, is Libertarian Realist coming back? I hope he's coming back.
If we hear snoring, we know we've screwed up, right?
Yeah, exactly. If he's He's back there snoring. I don't know.
You know, I'd have only one thing to add to your really excellent summary there, and that is that I'm not even sure the origin of leftism is in Christianity. I think it's just an eternal human pitfall. The Greeks called it hubris, but we might call it solipsism.
Well, I meant that it entered, because I buy into the Nietzsche narrative in on the genealogy of morals, where you have the slave underclass who basically inverted the master values of the Romans. And so it entered, and then, of course, it spread to Northern Europe and has infiltrated that. And, it, you know, Northern Europe used to have more of a master kind of more of a warrior type religion. You know, Wotan and Thor and Jesus Christ are very different deities, right? One is a suffering servant nailed to a stick, and the other one is a warrior, right? So you have very different values. Death in battle is valued by the Vikings, whereas pride is a sin in Christian morality. Pride is a cardinal sin, and in you know, master morality, it's not that way, right? It's actually a virtue. So that's what I meant, is that it most people are assuming Christian values to some extent in the West. And that's where you get, you know, like Nietzsche pointed out that the equality of souls before God, right? And then you have the modern thing, the equality of souls before the law, right? So that's basically where I'm coming from. But go ahead. I apologize for interrupting.
Oh, no problem. I was just going to say that I think if you leave a large group of humans together, they will always invent those kinds of things. And I think that Christianity also is generally misinterpreted, partially because no one really wants to admit this because it offends the fundamentalists, but it's basically a bunch of smart Jewish people writing down the best of Greek and Hindu and Middle Eastern thought and putting it in a digestible narrative, which encourages people to interpret it on themselves, by themselves, sorry, which creates the presumption of universal reason and the ability to equally understand things and creates the basis of equality in that. But I don't see that as a product of Christianity. Rather, I see Christianity as a product of it. I think this is a threat. This is a problem, a pitfall that every civilization runs into because humans tend toward this type of individualism. And through that, they become solipsistic. And then in groups, through a process that I call crowdism, they insist on equality and other forms of control that are basically designed to keep people who know better from stopping them from doing whatever crazy stuff they're doing.
Well, I gotta stop you there, because I think we're having some issues with understanding individualism, because when I think of feminism, I think of collectivism, because feminism is a kind of collectivism. Of course, that depends on how you're using the terms. So I'm kind of wondering if you could define how you're using the term individualism, because like I'm a aristocratic individualist like Nietzsche. Nietzsche was an individualist, but how are you using that term?
Individualism means anyone who believes that their perceptions are more important than reality. They're unwilling to direct their perceptions toward reality and are directing them inward. The reason I use the term individualism is that it expresses exactly what's going on. These people are not nihilists. They're a type of fatalists, but that's sort of secondary. What they really are is people who believe only in themselves and are willing to impose their values on reality without any kind of basis. And I think Nietzsche had some really good points, but here's where I think he really missed the boat in many ways. Individualism, you know, and Richard Spencer spoke of this recently at one of his appearances, individualism is the death of the West. What has made the West work is that our people have been reflective, they're willing to perceive reality, perceive themselves, understand their own limits, and then act toward a higher qualitative level of adaptation. And right. I think that's it.
Right. Well,
individualism is what the Greeks might have called hubris. It's the opposite direction.
Right, but
it's assuming that we are gods.
Hold on. But Nietzsche said that individualism was for the few, for the strong, right? And that's what I'm saying. I'm not saying individualism, like everyone ought to be an individualist. I say that only these few, these type men, these atheists I was referring to, are individualists. It's not that they're becoming individualists. It's just in their nature to do so, right? So they're more like the lion rather than the sheep, right? And most people are more like the sheep. And what I mean is that they're independent-minded, right? They're very independent-minded. They don't need the herd to define, they don't need something to be subjugated to, if that makes sense. So I think, yeah, it is destructive if you try to make everyone an individualist, if you're saying that's the ideal for everyone, because not everyone can do that, and nor would it be healthy for society if everyone was like that, right?
Definitely. Although I think you'll find the aristocratic spirit is not very individualistic. They tend to simply be very, very realistic. And I don't think they have a need for the division between self and herd in that way. They instinctively recognize that they're wired differently and that they can use their abilities to achieve better results than the herd is going to achieve. And I think that's all they're thinking about. I don't think they would fall into that individualist camp. And I think, you know, you look at a great book like The Odyssey, you might see the whole thing as a story of one man struggling with his own hubris. He becomes arrogant beyond his station. The gods have no problem with him being arrogant as long as he limits himself to where his place is in the order of things, sort of like that golden chain of being that's often talked about in older literature. There's a natural order. We all have a place within it. I think aristocrats are not individualistic because they see themselves as a means to an end. They're not cucked by the herd, but at the same time, what guides them is not themselves either. It is their analysis of reality.
Okay. I'm not exactly sure that I'm understanding all of that, but I think when you say hubris and you were talking about someone who's arrogant, that sounds like egotism to me. That sounds like someone who's deluded. When I use the term egoism, I'm not referring to someone who's egotistic, who's deluded about their own self-worth or what they have to offer or what, you know, what their abilities are. So maybe we're just kind of talking past each other and using the same terms but in different ways, perhaps.
Perhaps, though at the same time, I think this is one of the bigger philosophical issues of our time. Think about it this way. If you were an all-powerful creature, if you could do anything, would you spend much time worrying about your own impulses? You wouldn't. You'd have overcome them. And I think that's a lot of what, when Nietzsche talks about the aggressive man and the warlike man, especially against themselves, I think this is what he means. They're stripping aside the parts of their personality that are dedicated to the self in a neurotic sense, and they're allowing this purely functional being that has some sort of transcendental understanding of life to emerge. And if you look at kings, at really noble people, at aristocrats, they all tend to have this tendency. They're not obsessed with themselves. They act independently, but it's not based purely on their arbitrary choice. It's based on the fact that they have a higher understanding of how things work in reality, and so they apply themselves to that.
Right, but Nietzsche also talks about how society is to be sacrificed to those greater individuals, right? That a healthy society, a healthy aristocratic society, is where the herd is sacrificed for the betterment of these higher individuals, right? And you see this in not only in his published works, but also in you know, his works that were later published by his sister Elizabeth. Of course, he never, you know, finished his political philosophy, but we can still draw that much from it that he saw an aristocratic society as one where, you know, the herd, if you will, exists for the betterment of for a higher type. And he saw that what was good about man is that it was a rope to something better. It was something on the way to something greater than mere humanity, if you will.
Yeah, I formulate that, the first part there, I formulate as you either have the best oppress the rest, or the rest oppress the best. And the second part, I think he's talking about his Overman there. And that's when he says humanity is a rope leading over the chasm, what he means is that we have some evolution left to do. And he sees that as starting with your higher man, but I don't think he's saying that they're going to be purely individualists. What he's saying is they're going to act on their own authority, but they're not doing it for the reasons that a herd person would. And to me, individualism is herd logic. If you're fascinated by yourself and you're looking for reasons that you and your feelings should come before reality, then that to me fits within his slaves and masters paradigm, except that reality has become the master. The individual is the slave, and yet thinks he's the master.
Right.
Well, it's a confusion, and this kind of goes more Buddhist or Hindu than that, but I think at the same time it's a very classic European approach. You might find this in the Odyssey, the Aeneid, those kind of older works. Sorry, go ahead.
Well, I think these individuals are suited to rule because they see reality for what it is, right? They're not looking for some sort of crutch, and they're able to make those tough decisions based on the facts, right? And not what we see now today, which is based on some crazy ideal like multiculturalism and, everyone just, you know, getting along and world peace. Like, if you contrast the heaven or ideal, when we're talking about anybody's heaven, we're talking about an ideal, you're seeing that the Vikings' heaven, for example, consists of feasting and fighting. Well, what do we do now? We feast and we fight. These are very realistic things that is in the nature of life. Life seeks power and it seeks to dominate other forms. It seeks to impose its will on other forms. And what you see with the liberal ideology, the globalism and all that shit, it's more akin to the Christian notion of heaven, which is the lion lays down with the lamb. Well, this is anti-life. That's just not the way life works, right? It's a thing that will never be actualized, and there will always be hierarchy, and there will always be, there will always be conflict, right? And I just see that the master kind of ideal is more in tune with reality. It's actually reachable, right? Whereas the slave type, which is very utopian and it's all about lessening the burden of life, right? It's about that, whereas pain in mass morality is more like pain is something that's good because it's something that is makes one stronger, right? It's just two different psychological ways of looking at things, right? It's two different psychological conditions, attitudes about existence. One may, in its extreme, lapse into antinatalism, and the other one, in its extreme, would be, you know, more like a Might is Right type thing. I don't know if you've ever read Might is Right by Ragnar Redbeard, right?
Yep.
That kind of thing. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. That's kind of how I see it. I don't know if that helps.
Well, I guess there's a Hegelian trap here in that if we know the herd acts a certain way, the last thing we want to do is make our actions a reaction to what they're doing. Instead, we would do what is just purely logical and sane, which is to adapt on a higher level. And when you look at how human civilizations are composed, you know that throughout all the years, even before Christianity, outside of the West, the main way they exterminate themselves has always been revolt of the lower classes. And this has always come about through some kind of egalitarian philosophy. And it has always had certain pretenses, such as being pacifistic. And one of the great benefits that I've found in thinking about all this stuff is that it stopped me from interpreting liberalism as an ideology, and instead I see it simply as a pathology. And I realize that the statements they make are not true. In fact, they're designed to be deceptive. They're sales statements. So when they say they're pacifistic, what they're really saying is don't fight me because I come here to take over. Nietzsche, I think, referred to it as the ideology of the parasite at some point, and he's completely correct. So let's just for a moment conjecture, what would an aristocratic human being do? I mean, what would their perspective be? Well, I think first they'd recognize that the herd is exactly as it is because that's the limits of its ability.
Right.
The herd is the herd because that's all it can do. Then it realizes that civilization is worth doing. Then it realizes to some degree that the biggest challenge for any human is getting over themselves. They have to get over their own pretense, their own quest for self-importance, and instead just become pure realists who are driven by a desire to create and who find meaning through that. And at that point, you get your sort of humble warrior king, your philosopher king, somebody who is not really an individualist at all, but they're also, you know, not in any way part of the herd. What they're doing is just using their abilities as they are able to, as they're designed to. And they've separated themselves from all of the pretense and doublethink and confusion of the herd. For example, this is one of the secrets I write about on my blog. Collectivism is actually a form of individualism. It's a group of people bonding together to demand that their individualism be tolerated, despite the fact that it's mildly sociopathic.
Okay. That's interesting. That's an interesting way of looking at it. So what do you see... where do you see the alt-right going? Where do you see the right-wing movement that we've experienced over the last couple of years, especially since the emergence of Trump? What do you see? What are the things that we can do to overcome, to move in that direction and to overcome leftism?
You know, I think the hardest battle is in the soul. We have to gain some mastery of ourselves. You know, we're a small group. We're probably 2-5% of the population, but that's all that's needed to create the conditions for power transfer. And we have the ability in our hands, but we need to really be able to visualize what we actually want. And the alt-right's real stumbling block is that it doesn't quite know where it wants to go. It's a big tent. You know, there's a number of different inputs. There's libertarianism. There's HBD. There's white nationalism. There's regular nationalism. There's a neo-reaction. There's all these different things. There's the new right. There's all these different things coming together. And we've sort of kind of found an intersectional path through them. But at the same time, that doesn't mean we know what our end goal is. What is it we actually desire? And I think Richard Spencer jokingly, but very sanely, put a face on it when he said, yeah, we envision fields of wheat filled with pretty women and happy families, and then there's spaceships flying above to explore the stars. I think that's the kind of vision we need. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you mentioned the aristocratic element, and I think that's absolutely got to be something modern people have to... I think this is the dividing issue for everyone. If you're able to accept that aristocracy is necessary, you have left behind modern thinking. But if you cannot, you are still basically in the leftist camp. And that, I think, was one of the hardest jumps for me to make. But when I did make it, I was like, of course, on the other side, everything makes a lot more sense. And you start seeing how the leftist paradigm is entirely built out of personality artifices, and it really has nothing to do with ideology or logic at all.
Right. Yeah, I kind of like, I wasn't really involved in politics till recently. So, and I'd never voted ever in my life. And, you know, I'm like 36 now. And so I kind of stayed out of that. It wasn't till, I want to say not last year, but the year before that, so like 2015, that, let's put it this way, I haven't owned a TV since 2006, right? But I started to see the, just how leftist this country has become. And I just couldn't get to the point where I couldn't even watch TV anymore because I just saw the narrative and anything, the sitcom, the news, whatever. And I didn't really realize just how biased the media was until this past year with Trump, and that the constant lying and just skewed coverage of, you know, of the Trump election and stuff. So that was really something that made me question. And then also, like, but I wasn't surprised when I seen all these kids protesting everywhere, because I know just how permeated the educational system is with leftist ideology. And so that's kind of, you know, it's made me black-pilled in a lot of areas. It kind of makes me wonder, and I know I've said that more than once on the show, that, you know, I question whether the right can ever win another election because of how brainwashed the next generation will be, you know, and this generation is. So, because they're just, I mean, academia is just, you know, the educational institutions are just basically factories where they're pumping out all of these brainwashed minds. And most of these kids, I mean, you go to talk to any of these, you know, confront any of these protesters, they are absolutely clueless about pretty much anything concerning politics or, you know, how the country works, right?
Or hygiene.
Or, yeah, exactly. They're just basically what would we expect if there are only two types of humans, right? The herd and the, let's say, more independent, right? So I don't know. That's I kind of see a gloomy future. The Trump winning was kind of a positive thing because I didn't think he was going to win. And it's funny because I never really cared whether anybody would win, but I cared whether he would win because I saw how corrupt that the left was, and I just felt like I just wanted to see lefties cry. You know, that's what I wanted to see. And anything that would make them cry was just awesome. I mean, it's been like New Year's, you know, when he won. So it's been fabulous. I hope that you know, this trend will continue, I suspect that the left is going to be just as truculent through, you know, the next 4 years. But, you know, I really think that there's somehow we've got to not only change the cultural narrative, which is what I think the alt-right is pretty good at, with their memes and their trolling and their creating media and different things. The Daily Show and Chris Cantwell has a good show going, and just these campaigns that the new right, if you want to call it that, the alt right is, you know, it's rearing its ugly head on the scene, and it's influencing people. And I just hope that it continues to influence more and more people. Something to counteract the cultural Marxism that is being pumped into people's heads, you know. And so it's not just a question of changing the cultural narrative, but also the educational narrative. We've got to get these people out of the positions they're in as far as academia is concerned. That's what I see has got to change. I think media is going to be easier. I think the more the alt-right takes its toll on society as a whole, the more influences I think the media can be turned around at some point, but or discarded, because we already know there's a poll that came out fairly recently that they had like a 50% approval rating among Democrats. And I'm talking about CNN, you know, CNBC, all those fucking, you know, NBC. I think it was like 20% or something like that among independents and like a 15% among conservatives. So, you know, they're not doing too well. They have a worse approval rating than Congress. And so I guess it's part of the reason why I'm doing this show is to kind of put something else out there, some alternative kind of media source where people can hear alternative ideas instead of this PC bullshit. So I don't know. That's kind of why I'm doing this, you know, And also to talk to interesting characters like yourself. I've been wanting to read your book. I'm definitely going to do that and let you know what I think. And I think what I'll do is I'll send you a free PDF copy of my book, which, if nothing else, I know we seem to agree on quite a bit, but if nothing else, will give you some pretty good arguments against moral realism and things like that, or utilitarianism, or John Rawls' The Veil of Ignorance, or Divine Command Theory, or any of those things that I touch on. It's definitely an interesting read, and I do a chapter on Nietzschean idealism, which you might find interesting at the very least. And then the last chapter is my kind of what I call political nihilism, which is basically just a negation of political ideology. So it's basically just moral nihilism applied to political philosophy. It's basically what it is. But it'll be interesting to read your ideas more in depth and take a look at your version of nihilism and stuff. So that's pretty cool. I think it's very interesting the way you're using nihilism in a very broad sense. So it seems to encompass not only morality but also political ideology as well.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Well, when you have a high-level influence like that, there's no way it's not going to influence your politics. And, you know, I really am looking forward to reading your book. I think it's gonna be great. I think you have touched on a lot of really important topics, and you've compiled opinions and at least starting points on a lot of these. And so that's very, very useful. You know, my book, I hope it doesn't get that review that the band got in Spinal Tap, you know, the two-word review, shit sandwich.
Oh.
But hopefully it'll live up to and exceed expectations. But this is a philosophy I've been working on for many, many years. It's fairly well articulated there, though it is in shorter essays. I have a longer book coming hopefully in the future called Parallelism, which expresses its counterpart, which is more of a metaphysical and political philosophy, sort of the counterpart to nihilism, because nihilism is basically a gateway. It's how you, if you're one of the people who can think about these things, it's how you purify your mind and get clear about what reality is and then develop yourself further so you can perceive more of it. And one of the things that's really interesting about realism of this sort is that it has infinite dimension. The more you learn, the more there is to learn. So you'll never be bored. It's sort of like an intellectual paradise. Now, you know, you hit on the alt-right, and I realize right now a lot of people in the alt-right are feeling kind of bummed. It's like, what comes next after the rise of Donald Trump? Was this our purpose? What are we here to do? What do we want? And, you know, I'd just like to say this. I think civilizations have like a cycle, a breathing cycle to them, where some idea, somebody does something that works, and then that, the goal becomes confused with the method, and the method becomes the goal. And so all the sheep start doing the same thing because that's what's been proven to work. And then everybody, they all emulate that. All of society is arranged around it. It becomes an emperor's new clothes type situation. When something isn't working, you can't say stop doing that because it has become a de facto religion. It regulates your social status if you do it correctly. It regulates how well you're going to succeed if other people control you in a job, if they control how much money you get, that kind of thing. So civilization's going to breathe with this. They kind of alternate between sanity and this gradually increasing insanity as everyone's emulating whatever worked in the past. They don't understand it. They're just following the herd, and then it stops working. So, okay, right now, leftism is that insanity. It never was sane, but right now, the herd has made it kind of the de facto religion of the West. And I tell you, I make predictions, and they're going to come true. We're going to beat this. And the reason is, it's old. It's calcified. It's full of lies. It has nothing useful for any normal person who wants to enjoy life. It is against joy of life. It is against enjoying yourself. It's against having independence of thought. It is a crushing, horrible Soviet-style system. And so we are the rebels fighting against this. We don't want a revolution. We're counter-revolutionaries. We realize that this whole period of history where we've gone off into this leftist Soviet jaunt has been a wrong turn. And we need to back up, go back to the last working example, turn around and try again. And I think that we have a lot of cultural support on our side. there's a lot of people out there who can't articulate. It's not, they don't have the ability, they don't have the time, the inclination, whatever. It's not their thing. They can't articulate what needs to be said. The alt-right is doing it for them. The American people, the European people, have lived for many generations now under a horribly oppressive system that never made it quite clear how oppressive it was, because it always hid it. And it hid it behind the Lügenpresse, it hid it behind academia, all the things you mentioned, how everyone's brainwashed in the schools. And everyone has been kind of miserable for a long time. And so it needs a comeuppance, and we are that comeuppance. We are coming here to rip the heart out of this thing and destroy it. And I'll say this also, the only way the alt-right can screw up, the only way, is if we fall short of what we actually want and settle for something less, like conservative, whatever, policies, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, I hope I can erase that black pill, and I know you use that term to mean the depression associated with that, because I think we're going to beat this, and I think you're doing a great thing here by giving people a forum to speak about these ideas, by getting your own ideas out there, by having interesting guests on, and I refer to the other two people on this call, obviously, you know, and yourself. You're doing a great thing. You're helping overthrow this calcified, disgusting, horrible, oppressive way of life and replacing it with some sanity and realism. Both of them, those are basically synonyms. Sanity and realism mean the same thing. You adapt to reality and then you start improving it qualitatively instead of questing about for some kind of, what was the term you used? Utopianism, projectionism, something like that to make you feel better by acting out, you know, whatever drama. So I think you're doing a great thing. I think we're going to win. But there's some hard times ahead as the alt-right tries to figure out exactly what it stands for. And that's why it's good that there are shows like this one where people are fighting out the underlying issues and vocabulary so that we can actually get to a point of understanding what we believe in. So really good work here, and I'm looking forward to reading your book.
Yeah, appreciate that. You know, I kind of shy away from identifying as alt-right, but I definitely agree with a lot of things that they would stand for. I think one of the things that keeps me from doing that is a lot of these people are very reactionary. Like they react against the modern culture that we're in now, the modern period, and then they try to dig up something from the past and say, that's us. So like National Socialism, for example, I'm highly against socialism, and Odinism or something like that. I think that we have to move forward. And I understand that not everyone's able to do that, to move forward in all, you know, all areas of their intellect. But some people probably do need that kind of, let's face it, delusion. But that kind of keeps me from really, I tend to shy away from, because of my nature, I tend to not identify with any groups, right? But I definitely am a fellow traveler in some ways, and see somewhat of a, to some extent, a common goal, which is to purge the left, right? It's kind of like with Trump. I don't agree with everything Trump does or says, but he's a means to an end, right? And that is to get rid of this slave pox that has dominated society, and that I think even if the alt-right fails, this civilization is going to be destroyed by the left, and it's going to come crashing down at some point. And then only the strong will be left to rebuild something anew. So that kind of gives me hope as well. As dreary as that may sound to a lot of people. But this is, I think, the era of the last man, what Nietzsche referred to, the last man. We are currently governed by a last man ideology. And I don't know, that's how I see it. Dion, you got anything to throw at us?
Actually, I did read an interesting article just the other day. So apparently Generation Z, which is the people coming out, their teenagers, not quite in their 20s yet, maybe early 20s. They're saying that they are the most conservative generation since like the 1940s.
Yeah, I've heard that as well. I don't know how true that is, but I think the thing that kind of discouraged me was that the fact that Hillary got the popular vote. So that's the thing that kind of discouraged me, but.
Yeah, but she got the popular vote in New York City and Southern California. The rest of the country basically voted for Trump.
Yeah, okay, but, yeah, I mean, and you would expect that out of a, you know, a metropolitan area that are usually governed by liberals, so, you know, that's, you know, and they're trying to hurt everybody in the cities now. So, I don't know. I guess you would expect that, yeah. But that's just saying that, you know, these epicenters, right, these cities are have more people in them than some states, right? Like, so, like, Montana, for example, has, like, maybe a little over a million people in it, right? And maybe they all voted Trump, but it's still the thing that discouraged me is that the fact that the majority of that she still won the popular vote, right? We're talking about numbers here. Obviously, he won the technical, you know, he won by the Electoral College, as far as that's concerned. But it still concerns me that more Americans voted for Hillary than they voted for Trump. And Hillary's, oh my God, you know, there couldn't be a worse candidate. you know.
But you also have to take into account the complete and total nonstop degradation of the Trump campaign by the mainstream media.
Yeah. And I'm sure that, you know, I'm sure that that woke up not just myself, but also woke a lot of other people up just watching that dishonesty from the media, the constant, you know, dishonesty. But, you know, it's so polarized now that anything Trump does, even if it's seen as a good thing, will not be admitted by the left. And any fuck up he makes, it's going to be a huge, they're going to blow it up into a huge thing, on the left, but on the right, it's whatever he does. Well, it's okay. You know, it's just very fragmented, you know, this society. And, you know, there could be a civil war for all we know coming up, you know. I hope California takes a hike and becomes its own country. That would be nice. And I say that as somebody who lived in California for over 10 years before I moved here to Keene, New Hampshire. So it's a lost cause. California just needs to fall off into the ocean or something.
You know, history has a lot of twists and turns. And in those twists and turns, what was considered universally agreed upon common sense one day, the next day is just dead and forgotten. And I think we're in one of those times. It's a sea change where people are no longer believing in equality itself, which is the root of leftism. And so, you know, you may be right. This society may have to have a civil war and fall apart, and the strong may have to rise from the ruins. But as somebody who read a lot of Julius Evola, I have to say that I think we've been among the ruins for a long, long time already. And what we're looking at now is a way to shed the people who we don't need so that the people who are functional, which is probably about 20% of the population, can rebuild without getting destroyed by whatever political events are in process on the world stage. So it's going to be a complicated time, but it's a good time. Leftists are not compatible with a conservative society at all, and they're realizing it, and we're realizing it. So the great split-up is inevitable.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, the country is split already. It's just, you know, not official, right? People are split mentally. And, you know, the country is divided up into, you know, different ways of thought. And that's for sure. I think that the fracture has always been there to some extent. Well, at least, yeah, to some extent. But for one, humans are naturally tribal. And so 300 million people is too much we. And as time has gone on, being an American has become more meaningless than ever. You know, as I said earlier on in this discussion, you know, as far as these people think, everyone on this planet is just the American in the waiting. You know, they're just, and anyone has the potential of becoming an American. It's just become so fucking meaningless. It's not like, being Swedish or being English, and even that's becoming meaningless because of mass immigration, but I'm talking about how it was, right? Being English was an ethnicity. It wasn't just a where you lay your head, right? And America's never really had that identity. America's always been at least a melting pot of different Europeans, different nationalities. So, long road. You know, as I said before, I see it more realistic as this land being split up into different regions, run by different systems, different kinds of systems, something I call, what is it, pan-secessionism. That being more realistic than trying to convince 300 million people to be more right-wing, like, I just don't think that's going to happen. There's always going to be, especially the more people that flood in here from war-torn shitholes, it's just going to be more and more fractured as you put more and more incompatible people together in one place.
Well, you know, I think you're really onto something with the idea of pan-secessionism. That's what Billy Roper calls balkanization, and it's obviously going to happen. The real factor we haven't mentioned here is government. For example, without affirmative action, without welfare and state benefits, without many of the things that we give away for free here or are mandated by government to be equally available to everybody, without that, do you think we'd be experiencing this flood of people? Well, I don't think so.
Well, of course not. And it's like, you know, if you don't want the ants in your kitchen, you got to keep the scraps off the floor and off the countertops. And so you got to kind of, you know, you got to shut your refrigerator to these people, and then they won't have a reason to come in. The reason why they're coming here, whether it be Mexicans or from the Middle East, is because of all this free gizme that shit, all this, you know, free welfare and you know, dole outs that we're giving people. Obviously, if we don't have that shit, it's only for American citizens, then the Mexicans are going to stop hopping the border because they're not going to get anything. Right. And, That's how I see it. You got to turn off the fucking faucet, and you know, put a lock on that shit so they don't have a reason to come in. Stop incentivizing these people to come in. That's our big problem right now.
You know, I think that's a really good point. And I think the other point is, with freedom of association restored, with things like civil rights law and affirmative action out of the way, you'd see people separate into their own little groups, as you summarize or hypothesize with pan-secessionism. And when that happens, you're going to start to see it's going to be more of a cultural identity, who's American, and new cultural identities will arise. But those that don't find a cultural identity fit here are going to rapidly be leaving. And I think the consequence of balkanization is going to be that America will revert back to its original course as being basically a Western European nation.
Yeah, well, I'd said, you know, we have a better... I think I was talking to the Libertarian Realist about this. I don't know. He must be really cooking up a feast or something. But we were talking about if, let's say, pick Montana or like the Northwest Corridor, if all whites decided to move there and concentrate there, then they could have... So let me back up a bit. So I live in New Hampshire. And it's the Free State Project, right? So all these libertarians have moved here for the Free State Project. It's where basically all these libertarians have decided to come to, you know, come to New Hampshire because they're more able to affect political change if they concentrate in a given geographic region versus being spread out all over the United States, right? So their votes are going to count more in one state than if they were spread out all over the different states, right? So they've moved here to, quote, make a difference in their lifetime. And what I'm saying is that we have a fat chance in hell of changing the entire United States, and we have a better chance of moving to somewhere like Montana that has like a million people and like, 99% white, moving there and saying, you know, and then affecting the local stuff there and getting the United States government out of there. We have a better chance of moving to somewhere like Montana and succeeding from the rest of the United States than we do of changing the entire United States, if that makes any sense.
I think it makes sense, but to me, it seems clear that the United States, as it has been for the past 70 years, has already collapsed, and people are looking for something new. So this is a time where there's natural fragmentation and there's natural experimentation. So I'm not so much concerned with finding little secessionist areas that would then be easy to suppress. I'm concerned with the fact we have a cultural wave, while we still have an ethnic majority in this country, that's now pushing for something entirely different. And the fact that there's a fair number of people who are deluded and want the other thing, I don't think is as much of a problem, because now there's resolve against them. And you're actually seeing a lot more people day by day, I think, defect from the leftist camp. You know, normal people, not the crazy blue-haired guys burning down cop cars and trash cans and stuff, but normal people. I think they're backing away from it. And they may also be backing away from the idea that a whole lot of democracy is a good thing. So there's going to be a number of really subtle pathways that power can be transferred. And especially depending on the consequences of what Trump does, it could be much more of a transfer than anyone realizes. Much as Obama was a huge transfer. I mean, the whole country swung really hard left. Well, now we may be swinging really hard right. And it's happening in England as well. It's happening in mainland Europe. It's happening in the Philippines. There's other countries where people are speaking up, you know, the Netherlands. So I think we're looking at a cultural wave where people are really getting sick of what's been going on. And the change as a result may be more radical than anyone realizes at this time. In fact, I believe it will be.
Yeah, but the question is, you know, you've already, like, let's just concentrate on the United States. So the United States already has a huge non-white population here, and the alt-right wants a ethno-state. The likelihood of getting all of these non-whites out of here, given the political difficulties that we're under, is very, I think, very naive. And that's why I'm saying that to concentrate in a given geographic location where you can actually affect local, like, you can change state laws a lot easier than to change, you know, to get the U.S. government to do anything, especially if you're spread out and they're worried about, well, what about the Latino vote? And what about the black vote? And what about the, you know, pandering to all these different groups? I don't know. That's how I'm kind of looking at it.
Well, you know, we got to talk about the Civil War here, which was the last attempt at secessionism, and it didn't go so well. So keeping that in mind, it seems to me that actually change is more likely, because what we need is not so much changing laws, like, per se, it's just removing them. We need to remove 70 years of bad leftist ideas and then consider transition to a different type of system. And I think this is likely because democracy has continually caused problems for people, and I think a lot of people are willing to abandon it at this point. There's a rising monarchist sentiment among even Americans, up to about a fifth of the population at this point, according to some estimates. So we're looking at a really vast cultural change. And, you know, everything you say is true. It would be really hard to overnight get rid of all people who weren't white from North America, at least without doing something horrible. But here's the thing. If we remove all those crazy leftist laws, for example, affirmative action, civil rights laws, welfare state, socialist-style benefits, then I think you're looking at people who are gently encouraged to self-deport, because what they came here for is no longer here for them, and the population that they thought was going to provide them with an income is no longer willing to do so. So at that point, you're looking at an entirely different situation, and we already know the United States is in deep trouble. I mean, under Obama, it fell in prestige, it fell in power, all sorts of things like that. Now we're looking at the question of, is there anything left that we can salvage? Because the United States as a brand has kind of ruined itself. It's no longer what it once was. And there's just a lot of resistance to our being a superpower as a result. It's a multipolar world. So with that out of the way, I think that we are in a fertile time for massive change. And that change will take the nature of going back to blood, as Tom Wolfe says. We're going to go back to our tribes, and we're going to go back to our so-called primitive ways. You know, we may come up with a new religion, but we're going to have some kind of religion. I don't even know if it'll be a metaphysical religion. It may just be a go out, hang around with the trees, and sacrifice some Untermensch type religion. You know, kill the annoying guy at your office and offer him up to Thor. I don't know, but I think we're going to see people changing their ways. And I think you make a good point with, we can't just go back to the past. But the thing is, we're not talking about going back to the past. We're talking about methods that have worked for all time for human society that we deviated away from, And now people are questioning whether that deviation wasn't just one big screw-up. So I remain cheerful. I mean, there's a lot of work ahead and probably bloodshed and horror, but, you know, people love that stuff. So it's all going to work out.
Yeah. Is there anything in the chat box there, Dion?
There's no questions. They're just
bullshit
banter.
Shit posting there.
Yeah.
All right. Well, how long have we been going there? About 2 hours?
Yeah.
Something like that. All right. I guess we'll end the show, man. But it was good to have you on, and I'm sorry about all the technical difficulties, and you know, that kind of sucks, but you know what it is. I'll get better at it as I keep doing it. So yeah, it was good to have you on, and very interesting, stimulating conversation. And I'll look forward to reading your book, and maybe I'll get back to talk about it a little bit more on the show after I read it or something, and stuff. So yeah.
Hey, that would be great. You know, thank you for the interest. Thank you for having me on here. Dion, it's great to meet you and Libertarian Realist and to get to have a little chat in here. Gentlemen, it's been really a pleasure, and I hope we can do it again sometime, or we can possibly have you on our podcast, which we're calling Nationalist Public Radio, which we're doing from AmericaWithAK.org.
Oh, I'd love that. Yeah, that'd be great. Sure.
Cool.
Yeah. Just shoot me an email or a little message on Skype or whatever. You know how to get a hold of me. Just shoot me something, and I'll come on the show, and we can bullshit a little more.
Sounds like fun.
Yeah.
Okay, gents. Well, thank you for doing this, and let's talk again soon.
All right.
All right.
All right.
If you have enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and share on your favorite social networking site. Also, please head on over to www.powernihilism.education. Follow and subscribe via Google+ or Gmail so that you can receive notifications concerning future essays and other content. On my site, you also have the ability to read my book concerning metaethics for free and or purchase the hardcover edition. Thanks and stay tuned.